hey everybody, welcome to Write On, the podcast from Final Draft. We are here to talk about all things screenwriting. Today we have an interview with Liz Hannah, creator and showrunner of The Girl from Plainville.
Michelle, what is it?
Conrad's dead.
Who's Conrad?
Leading up to his suicide, there are text exchanges between the two of them. Thousands of them.
What motive could she possibly have for telling him to kill himself?
You don't get it. This is our love story.
Right On's Sade Sellers chatted with Liz about what drew her to telling this story based on a real-life case, approaching the characters without judgment, the importance of making the hard and scary decisions instead of the easy ones when it comes to storytelling, and more. Check it out.
Welcome back to Write On, everyone. It is Sade here again. I am so excited to be back to talk to you about this next show because I got to see the first three episodes, which you will soon, and I am obsessed. So I've been looking forward to this interview all day long. I am here with the show's creator and showrunner, Liz Hannah. Hello, Liz.
Hello, how are you?
I'm so good. Okay, so first I want to get all my fangirling out. I've been following you on Twitter for a long time. So No, but you don't have to be sorry because I really love at least who you are on Twitter, which is very outspoken. You're very much the person that's anti-bully. You want to stick up for everyone. You're on the right side. And I enjoy following you, listening to things you say, and being very passionate about what you believe in online. So it's a pleasure to meet you in person.
I appreciate it. Thank you so much. That's so nice.
It actually is perfectly fitting for the show, The Girl from Plainville, which we're talking about today, in terms of bullying and sticking up for yourself and saying something. It's right up your alley. So I want to know, did you take us through, like, where did this come from? Like, we know there's been a lot of documentaries about this case with Michelle. Michelle Carter. If you don't know, you guys, it's the texting suicide case. We've all heard of it, but I actually only knew a little bit of it. So when did you first come in contact with this case?
So I think, like, everybody had a very peripheral relationship with it in terms of I'd heard exactly what you just said, the texting suicide case, and saw, I think, the reaction from the media, the reaction from the general public towards Michelle, towards the case, which was very vitriolic, very much making her the villain. But that was about it. That was, you know, so that was sort of I think I passively knew about it. I hadn't watched the documentary when the documentary came out, but I had heard great things about it. It really came to me because my partner, Patrick McManus, the co-creator, co-showrunner of the show, he has a overall deal at UCP, which is a studio, who had bought this article called The Girl from Plainville by Jesse Barron, which was an Esquire. And he was interested in making it. Elle Fanning was interested in attaching, along with Brittany Conward, who's our other executive producer, also my producing partner and manager who I've worked with for a number of years. And I had just made a movie with Elle like a year earlier and had a great experience. It was something that we talked about doing again. And so they sent me the article. Patrick really wanted a partner in it. He's not a adolescent teenager as much as he would like to have us think he is. And I get to make these jokes because he's not here to yell at me, which is exciting. And I was really, I would say, hesitant to dive into it before reading the article and getting into the documentary, all for the exact same reasons that we mentioned were what I knew about it, which was very peripheral. And I didn't really, I'm very interested in the gray area of people and morality and ethics, but this one felt really very touchy to me. And then I read the article and realized very little I knew. And then I watched the documentary and realized how even less I knew. And then I talked to Jesse and to Patrick, and really just as you start to peel away the layers, you realize just how little was talked about of what actually happened in this case and what actually happened between these two people and the sort of mutual toxicity between the two of them. Mm-hmm. And that was really a place that I felt that I could lean into. A character in Michelle, a character in Conrad, and also in their families that felt really deep to explore. And so I think once it became even harder than I thought it would be was when I started to lean in.
That is oh my gosh. And it's so true what you're saying. The, like you said, the macro side of it, which is all I know, which is she told her friend slash boyfriend maybe to kill himself, but there's so much more to it. And I actually enjoyed watching it in this way through narrative rather than a documentary, because it just, you get so many little moments that documentaries miss. One in particular I ask you about later, because it was my favorite moment to the end of episode one. Obviously, you know what it is already, but I was just like, this would not have been the documentary, and this is awesome. I do want to ask for the listeners, because most of our listeners are screenwriters, if not all of them, the technicalities of working with true stories like this, because there's a few pieces working here. Not only is it a true story, but it's also a piece of IP, someone's article from Esquire. So like, if you don't mind, because I know you do a lot of this on script notes, I listen to the episodes you guest on too. What does that look like for a writer when you have to get the rights for an article, but also you're dealing with real people and real things that happened?
Yeah, it's a great question. True stories are really hard. I keep coming back to them. It's for me, you know, I started my career with The Post, which was something that I wrote sitting at my dining room table with no thought that it would ever get made. So I just wanted to write this on spec and hope I got an agent. I had no expectation or anticipation of where that was going to go. And in some ways that was very freeing in terms of how to adapt a true story. In some ways it was very scary, because that's not at all how somebody should adapt a true story. But it did, I think, very much influence how I attack them, which is I try to approach every true story as a narrative. It is not a documentary. You know, in the case of The Post, there are plenty of articles and docs and books and things you can read. It was about journalists. Every journalist writes a book about it. So it's plenty you can read about it. This was an interpretation of Katharine Graham's journey and struggle through it and ultimate success through the publishing of the papers. And with The Girl from Plainville, it was similar. It was trying to dive into these characters and feel that there is integrity to who their characters are in terms of who they are in real life, and feel that they are recognizable in real to who they are based off of. But at the same time, having the ability to explore some of these deeper conversations in ways that you can't in a documentary necessarily. There's a lot of lawyers involved, that's for sure. Yeah. There's a lot of conversations about, I think, not only the integrity of the characters, but the integrity of the words. In this case in particular, you know, so much of what influenced the characters, the show, everything was text messages between Conrad and Michelle, which we had access to. And that really shaped not only who they were together, but who they were with their friends, the arc of their relationship. And I think that we felt very strongly about making sure that those texts were as accurate as humanly possible to what we've portrayed on screen, so that you do feel that that's real, that what they said to each other was real and where it came from. So this one was a little tricky in terms of having those text messages and portraying them that way. But it's all, you know, it's all, I think, if they feel three-dimensional and they feel like they are lived in people, then that feels like at least I've done part of my job.
I do want to ask, because as we're taping this, a similar show on the same streamer, Pam and Tommy, is also out, and it's getting a little critique because it's, you know, these real people, these things, awful thing happened to this real people, which is very similar to what your show covers. What is the balance between we have to tell this story, but it's also TV? So I also have to fill in some blanks that I don't know, and also have to keep people entertained. Like, how do you find that balance as a writer?
Sure. It's a great question. I mean, I do work in television and film, and there is entertainment value in it. You know, that's a part of it. I think for us, we approached this show from the beginning. It was actually the first conversation Patrick and I ever had, was approaching this show and these people with empathy, approaching the case with empathy, approaching Michelle and Conrad and Lynn and all of the characters with empathy and without judgment, and really going in. And that didn't mean that we were trying to make anybody a hero, or we were trying to change a narrative, or that we were, you know, having an opinion on necessarily the narrative. It just meant that we were coming in without judgment. And that was really important, I think, into approaching these characters in this way, that these characters are controversial, and there's a lot of controversiality in this case. So I think we tried to do it that way, and, you know, and hope that you know, whoever goes into this, watching this show with a preconceived notion, which I think everybody will, regardless of what your notion is, it's a case that, as I said, is controversial and it's hard to not have an opinion about. My hope, and I think our hope when making it, was that you're able to take a step back from whatever that opinion may be and put yourself in the shoes of any number of the other people who were involved in it and say, I didn't know that, or that complicates it a little bit more for me, or, you know, you have empathy for them. I think that was really our goal. And hopefully that's how an audience feels.
I will say, I think you achieved that because, and I'm only judging off the first three episodes, but it was kind of hard sometimes for me to swallow that Conrad may not have been this perfect victim and that he was flawed just as much as Michelle, if not a little bit more. I think that was really hard because you have this image of, well, this is the person who suffered, they're gone. But you also brought such great humility to his character and gave him layers. It's not just going to be this art type person that we're all looking and to aspire to. This is a real human being that had some issues. So I loved that aspect of it because I'm like, okay, well, they both have things about them I don't really love, and they both have things about them that I actually really admire. Without giving it away, because I think it's so remarkable, I actually pinned it on my Twitter that I'll come back to talk about this scene when the show airs and everyone can watch it. I want to know logistically on the page, and then I want to talk about the production. Logistically on the page, if you can say it without giving away, what that last beat of that first episode looks like written out. I don't even know if that's fair to ask.
I hope people will listen to this after they watch it so they know what we're talking about. Because it's for me, it's one of my favorite parts of the show. And it was something that Patrick and I came to super early on. And it was kind of the thing that made us all lean in a little bit. The thing that I will say is that it has to do with Glee. That's something that widely known about Michelle Carter is that she was, or maybe not widely known, but that she was very infatuated with Glee. She was very infatuated with Lea Michele in particular and Corey Monteith and their whole romance. And so from the very beginning, Glee was an influential part to Michelle's character. So the scene that we're talking about has a bit to do with Glee. What it looked like on the page, you know, it looked pretty straightforward, actually. I wish that there was a lot. I wish I could take credit for it. I really can't. When you have Elle Fanning doing that, you kind of just walk away and thank your lucky stars that she's the one that's doing it. You know, as I said, I've worked with Elle before. We've done a movie together. This was obviously the longest long form we've done. We also produce, she's an executive producer, so we produced it together. And that was something that in the pilot, when we wrote that before we sold it to Hulu, that everybody was like, this is sort of where we want the show to live. This is really interesting to us because it wasn't easy. It wasn't easy for her to act in any way. She spent a solid 4 to 5 days watching that clip continuously and getting every single movement down. And we had her mimicking it and making sure she was doing it while we were rolling, which I'm sure made her so happy. In doing that, it's not just that, it's the emotional arc that she has as Michelle in that. So I think it's, for us, it was a really exciting challenge. For Elle, I think it was exciting. And then she hated us for a while. And now she's excited about it again. We've come back. But yeah, I mean, I think it kind of goes back to what we were talking about at the beginning, which is, I don't really like to do things unless they're hard and scary. Otherwise, I just think you can become very complacent, or I have been, at least in my career, or is that I've gone through periods where I don't want to do the hard thing. And then somebody else does the hard thing. And I'm like, well, is there only reason that I did it was because I was afraid? That feels like a very silly reason to not do something. And so that scene in particular kind of underlined how hard we were going to try and make our lives for the next 20 weeks in the room and subsequently making the show.
My gosh, because I mean, I'm watching it as a writer and as a producer and I go, okay, first of all, what she's doing is so simple on screen, but it is so hard. I'm sure it was a nightmare to get through, at least internally, and having to get there. And I curled up in my blanket, Liz, and I was like, she is so scary. Like I was terrified. I know it's not a horror film. I was scared. I was like, this is the scariest thing I've ever seen in my life. And I'm not going to say anything else. When it comes out, I'd like to DM you about it because there's so many other layers to it, just about Michelle being a white woman and the way she weaponizes that and so easily and being young and beautiful. And that is the scariest thing on the planet to me.
Mm-hmm. I mean, it's terrifying to me, believe me. I mean, I think it's, you know, it's interesting what you were talking about Conrad before. You know, a big part of everyone, I think, being interested in telling this story. And I know I speak for Colton Ryan, who plays Conrad, but I'll just speak slightly for him, which I know that this was a part of leaning into doing the show, was going to what you were talking about before, is that as much as this story has been about Michelle and Conrad, it's been about Michelle and the boy. It's never really been about him. He's never really had his time or due to be shown as the three-dimensional, complex, flawed, fantastic person that he was. And I think we had, we were really interested in the opportunity to show, you know, that there's complexities to him, that there are different layers to him, and also the complexity of somebody dealing with such severe mental health issues, that his family can view him one way and believe he is one person. And then with Michelle, he's a completely different person. And then with his friends, he's a completely different person. And that's, this exact same for her. And that's something, you know, we didn't talk about, but I've spent sort of the last few years focusing my work on things that deal with mental health. It's something I take very seriously. And I think we don't talk about enough in casual society. You know, I think oddly the pandemic has opened us up to having these conversations a little bit more, just because we've all had to deal with the fact that we all struggle with mental health, that we have to talk about it. Otherwise, and we're all stuck in our houses still, so we still have to talk about it. I think the thing for me that is the most unique about this story, and at the same time, the most relatable, is that you have absolutely no idea what's going on with somebody else. And that Conrad portrayed himself as somebody who was completely fine. And I use air quotes when I say fine, because who knows what that means. But somebody who, truthfully, his parents had no idea that this could happen, and that's not on them in any way. That's how good of an actor we can all be when we want to hide things about ourselves. And that the portrayal that I think Colton Ryan does as Conrad, and the way that we tried to approach it, is again with the empathy and with the sort of relatability of, we all do this. You know, I'll have a conversation with my parents that's one way, and I'll have a conversation with my husband that's another way, and I'll text my friends in a completely different way. And I think the relatability of that in terms of discussing mental health felt very real to me, and felt like something that everybody could find themselves connecting to.
That, I'm so glad you said that, because it actually increases my empathy more for this Michelle character, because like you said, we all have our different faces or different masks around different people. And I do it too. I'm a, like you said, I'm a different person around my doctor, who I tell the truth to, that I am. Sure. Yeah. My mom, when she says, how are you feeling? Great.
Awesome. Fantastic. Wonderful.
And I feel
stop asking questions.
Yeah, exactly. My doctor, I'm like, this hurts. This is weird. This doesn't make sense. Or your therapist, you know? So I love this conversation, because now I'm thinking back in the episodes and I'm like, oh, this is a little girl who just wanted to be accepted, and who just wanted people to invite her to things and have friends, and yes, be a little bit center of the attention, a little,
totally. We really approached this without trying to condemn or condone anything. I think the thing for me, and what you just talked about, is exactly how I felt about Michelle reading her texts and seeing and watching the documentary and watching the courtroom footage, was just somebody who was so alone, and somebody who just didn't want to be alone and didn't want to be isolated and wanted to be accepted and didn't know how to do that, and is like any awkward teenager, weird and doesn't know how to fit in. And like, I was a weird teenager. I didn't know how to fit into anybody and with anybody. And I think that is a connection that she and Conrad don't actually talk about that much, but is very clear in their conversations and clear in his conversations with other people. And something that felt so sad to me was that both of these people could be in a room of 100 other people and feel completely alone. And that the only person they could connect to was through, you know, the little black box that we all carry around with everywhere we go. So that was really something that I felt like with Michelle we could explore, and something that I hadn't seen Elle do also, which was really interesting, and something that was challenging because she hadn't done it before. And I say challenging, you know, she's can do anything. So I'm sure for her, but she was really remarkable in embodying Michelle and the physicality of Michelle being that loner. And so that for me is exactly what you're talking about. I think being sort of thematically about what it's like to be alone and the steps you'll take and the places you'll go to not be alone anymore and how that can skew.
And it's relatable. I think I've definitely been there, still getting there, even at my big age. I do want to touch upon, and this was also an episode of Script Notes that happened this week, but it perfectly ties into what I'm seeing here in your show, this main character syndrome, where you want to be the star of the film. So that's how I feel about Michelle at sometimes, where she is inserting herself into this narrative. It's really nothing to do with her. She's not the one that was hurt, but she is now the main star and she's enjoying the attention a little bit. Do you think is that something that was incepted in, or am I just reaching for themes now?
Well, I mean, I think we all want to be the stars of our own stories, right? I mean, I think as writers, it's also something that I try to approach whenever I'm writing anything, is that these supporting characters don't know they're supporting characters. They mm-hmm. they think they're the stars of the show, the ensemble of a movie. One, they go home at night and they have their own main character story. You know, they have their own movie that they're telling. So I think when you're doing something that has an ensemble, and we have an amazing ensemble of actors in this show and an ensemble of characters in this show, in order to, for me at least, to approach it so that they don't feel as just support systems, you're approaching them as main characters, you're giving them life and story. And I think I think that relates to Michelle and Conrad as well. You know, I think I'd like to be the main character of my own story. So I think it's really human and relatable. I think in The Girl from Plainville, it's obviously taken a step further. You know, Michelle, I think because of that isolation, because of the need to feel connected, it obviously spirals into another realm. But yeah, I mean, I think Conrad's the star of his own show. I think she's the star. And I think that unfortunately things happened and devolved in this story that were unfortunate.
I think I don't want to get too far into it either, but this whole Glee aspect of it is so fascinating to me, because there are times or moments I think I've had with friends and even family where I go, there are no cameras here. Like, what is this reaction for? What is this? What are you mm-hmm. like a Fleabag moment? Like, who are you talking to? You're looking over your shoulder. Like, you're not in a show. And that's mm-hmm. exactly what I'm getting for Michelle sometimes. I'm just like, what is the dramatics for? You are not on Glee. Mm-hmm. You're not on TV. Mm-hmm. You are a person in real life. And we won't get into that too much because you guys have to watch the three episodes that are going to premiere.
Well, the thing I will say about that though, is that I think, and Elle has spoken to this and I thought it was very eloquent, so I'll steal it and make it mine. But no, Elle said this, is that I think particularly about this generation of kids who grew up with social media, who grew up with their phones constantly tied to themselves mm-hmm. with YA novels, television, features surrounding them. It's very easy to become obsessed with being the star, mm-hmm. to projecting who you are on TikTok, Instagram, Twitter, whomever it is. We started this with you say you follow me on Twitter, which is great. It's also like part of me, you know what I mean? And that's, I think, what's really interesting, is it's not fully me. I mean, please, dear God, hope it's not fully me, but it's partially me. And I think that is what's really interesting about telling this story about this generation, is Michelle did sometimes, it's like, wait, there's no cameras here, Michelle.
Yeah.
You know, and I think that that is really relatable to kids of this era, and something that Elle has spoken to, is like, you grow up where you just have social media constantly, and you have the ability to, you're a no one in Oklahoma and you start a TikTok account and suddenly you have 15 million followers and you're making a ton of money. And that's just what culture has become. So I definitely think there's an interesting aspect to that, to Michelle's character, that was fun to sort of explore and play with.
Yeah. And I can't wait to see the rest of the season to see how this unfolds. Cause I know nothing about this case. So I'm actually waiting for your show to begin and start and finish so I can learn about it. I'm not going to read right now. I want to jump really quick. Okay. The show gets picked up. Awesome. Hallelujah. Is there a writer's room? Who's in it? How did you pick them? How does that all work?
Yes, there was a writer's room. We were super lucky. We would not have been where we are without them. Patrick McManus and I ran the room. It was it's six writers. Two or three of them had worked with Patrick on Dr. Death, which he had just, that room had just wrapped. He was about to go into production on season one. And a few of them were new to us. Our writer's assistant I brought on from The Dropout, which I had just finished previously. And it was an amazing group of humans, an amazing group of different perspectives. And I think, you know, like the truthfully, the one thing that we wanted was people who were approaching it with the empathy that we were trying to project onto the show or trying to approach the show with. So we wanted them to meet us there, and they did. And so 20 week room, anybody who knows me is like, you lasted 20 weeks in a room. I will say I lasted maybe 16 because we had some breaks in there. So, but Zoom room during the pandemic, I will say that it was probably the most tightly knit room I've ever been a part of for, I don't think for any other reason than a lot of the things that were happening at the time. We opened the room in August, 2020.
Oh, wow.
So we were, it was in the middle of social, cultural, racial unrest, the election, an insurrection, and a pandemic. And there was not a way, not that we would ever want to, but there was no way to avoid what was happening around us. You know, we couldn't just like go into our little Zoom room and click off what was happening. And I actually think, and we were talking about mental health, some pretty heavy things. So I think that was a real connective tissue to the room and to the show, was having this safe space and this place to be honest with each other and to be like, yo guys, I got to take a mental health day because this shit's really fucked up. And that has sort of, for me at least, has completely changed how I approach rooms. It's completely changed how I approach breaking shows. It's changed how I approach my career, which is just, you know, when you're sitting in a room with some pretty amazing humans, watching what's going on around you, and you're trying to talk about mental health, it puts into very clear perspective what your job is, and also that we're not frontline workers, and I'm not a Capitol police officer on the steps of the Capitol. So it makes you realize that there's tons of value in what we do, but everybody needs to take a breath and realize there's more important things out there sometimes. And so that was a really, I think, influential part for me about the show.
I love that, because I mean, the whole conversation, you've been talking really heavily about mental health. I have a therapist. I'm pro therapy,
yeah. Pro medication, pro whatever you need. Preach. Yep.
Me go too. So, yeah. And kind of related to this, for my last question, because the time flew by and I could ask you a million things, but I'll let you go, I promise. What advice do you have for your younger writer self, like for Liz on the come up?
It's a great question. I think I would say don't take things too seriously. That doesn't mean that you shouldn't take it seriously. That doesn't mean, you know, I take my job very seriously. I feel incredibly fortunate, incredibly lucky to have this job and to be able to tell the stories that I've gotten to tell and hopefully will continue to tell. It's that I think in my earlier in my career, everything felt like the beginning or end of the world. And that's just not a good way to be creative at all. It's not a good way to, you know, 90% of my job is trying to make something on a page relatable to other humans. And if you're taking it, if you're putting so much pressure on it, you don't get to have the fun of it, which is like, this is a really fun job. This is a really, we're really lucky to go to work and have fun and be creative and explore different people and relationships and things like, and different worlds. And so I think I would tell myself to take a break, like just take a breath. It'll all be okay. I think that's probably it. And I will also say the thing that I should have done that I didn't do, and there's about 17 people who are going to kick my ass after I say this, is when I was shooting the post, it was my first feature and I was on set the whole time, except for I think like a week. And I had like a dozen people tell me like, keep a journal. And I was like, no, I'm not a journal person. I'm good. Like, I'm not going to do it. And I wrote notes to myself like during some like very surreal things or advice that was getting thrown at me, but I didn't like write it down. And I really regret that. I really regret not having sort of a personal documentary of my experience, because it was bonkers. It was a bonkers, crazy, once in a lifetime experience that I have the memories of. But it would be different to go back and look at. And I've subsequently done that differently. And on my other projects, I've taken notes and been a little bit better about trying to remember these things. And it doesn't matter what project you're working on, what show you're in production on. It doesn't, like, Steven Spielberg doesn't have to be there for you to take notes. It is such every show, every project you get frustrated with at a certain point. Mm-hmm. Every show, every project you get, it's hard at a certain point. You're like, why did I do this? When you get to the other side and you can look at it and you have this collection of memories and this collection of experiences, I think it's really valuable just as a human to look at. So that would be my recommendation. That would be the unsolicited advice to younger writers when you're going into production is to take notes and listen and take more it you talk
at the top of the morning, because by the end of the day, you're going.
Oh yeah, you're done. You're done. Or I hope you get to be an on-set writer where you can sit in a chair all the time. Best job in Hollywood.
That's true. I was going to say, because that's producing work, do it at 5 a.m. because you're not doing it at midnight. It's not
exactly
happening. Liz, this has been an amazing conversation. Again, I could sit here and talk to you about the show forever, but I've only seen 3 episodes. And so will everyone else on March 29th on Hulu, you guys. And then after that, it will premiere every Tuesday for the rest of the season. But on March 29th, you can see the first 3 episodes on Hulu. Liz Hannah, the co-creator/co-showrunner for The Girl from Plainville. Thank you so much for coming on the show today. And I truly, truly hope we get to speak to you again.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for having me.
Thanks to Liz Hannah for coming on the show. The Girl from Plainville will be streaming on Hulu March 29th. And as always, thanks to you, our listeners. If you liked this episode, leave us a review. And if you haven't already, subscribe to the show on Apple, Spotify, Stitcher, or wherever you get your podcasts. For news about new episodes and more, like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter at Final Draft Inc., and on Instagram at Final Draft Screenwriting. This podcast is produced by Emma Vranich. Editing is by Sean Bonnet. Music by T. Kelly. Thanks again, everyone. Until next time, right on.